We have come to module 3, which means we are in the middle of this course, and this is going to be our lecture 9 and 10. module 3 majorly talks about protection systems, various types of protection systems, from fuses, breakers, the types of circuit breakers, from MCBs, miniature circuit breakers, earth leakage circuit breakers, molded case circuit breakers, and air circuit breakers, and also about protection relays. And in the second half of this module, they're talking about earthing and lightning protection system, definition types, factors to be considered in terms of the earthing systems, and also about the lightning system design, and some rules as per NBC and other relevant standards. We will quickly move on to this. So under the name of protection devices, we will, whatever we are going to study or cover is majorly nothing but your switches, right? So imagine whatever device we take up for discussion, imagine each of them as a switch, or a grander switch, or a switch in a different scale with more complications, more components, with more advancements, right? It is basically as simple as a switch, right? So keeping that clear, I will jump onto something which is called as a switch gear. In large industrial installations with a high voltage supply, or above, it will be necessary for the consumer to provide space for switch gear, right? And a transformer. So switch gear, okay, for domestic installations, every effort should be made to ensure that the intake position is in convenient position and not in corridor or any walkways or under a staircase, which is very inconvenient. And according to the standards, there are several dimensions to be and measures to be followed if we have to locate a switch gear. I'll leave that to you. So what is a switch gear? So it says in large installations, we will have to provide some space for the switch gear, and along with that, we will also have to provide some transformer, which means it is essentially stepping the voltage down from a higher voltage to a low voltage, right? So what is a switch gear? This is the domestic circuit or service that we already know, I assume. So the consumer electricity comes from the government supply. We have the meter where we get billed, and finally it goes to the consumer control units, and from the consumer control units, it is up to the consumer's idea and strategy and design to take it the way they want it, right? So the boxes that we see here, I'm sorry if the text is not very clear, but yes, the boxes that we see here is nothing but your a combination of switch gear and transformers. And what is shown here is how it is getting into the before it gets into the basically a different representation of what I've shown here, right? So this is where the government supply comes in, then it gets metered, then it again goes to the consumer unit, and from then it goes to various other spaces within the building. So that means why do we have to put these two images along with the switchgear image? So this is basically a substation. Substation, remember, if you could remember, it is a series of transformers performing different set of operations, but ideally it can either step down or step up voltages, or DC to AC, AC to DC, and we've studied about that in a transformer session. So why do we have to put these here under the name of switchgear? Right? So we will try to understand it in the next slide. So after these initial idea details have been arranged, and whatever the tariff metering is all agreed, the electricity distributor, which is the government, will install their service cable and cutout. These will usually be back underground, but in some cases it can be overhead as well. Every installation will be controlled by one or more main switches. This must be readily accessible to the consumer and as near as possible to the supply cutouts. The type and size of main switch gear will depend upon the type and size of the installation and its maximum total load. If it is making any sense, so we have been studying about this in using different terminologies. Every installation has to be controlled by one or more switches. What do we mean by one or more switches? We didn't talk about the switches, but we have always been talking about panels. We've been talking about LV panel, we've been talking about MV panel, we've been talking about HV panel, or HDLT, MT, So, but I've been always telling you that that box is going to have a huge number of control devices, and one among that is going to be these set of switches, right? So if you again see it in this box, it is all a box from outside, from whatever we could see. But what the perform that it performs, the controls that it is going to have, is what is going to differentiate them from each other. So depending upon the size and capacity of the facility, so we are going to have a couple of switches, main switches, and that has to be accessible by the consumer, and it should be near to the supply cutouts as well. So this box, again, even though it is just, I just told you that it is just a couple of switches, it is not going to be a couple of switches, or it can be a couple of switches. What is going to be the dictating factor here is the installation, the facilities, total requirement. So depending on that, depending upon how much of a current it is going to carry or handle, then the box size will definitely vary. So if there are a huge amount of capacity to be handled, so that means it is going to call for a big box which is full of switches by itself, right? So that is our switch gear. In other cases, it is also called as a DB. We've been studying about DB. Again, a box, distribution board, collects, distributes. Simple as that. Collects electricity, receives it from some source, usually the government, meter, distributes it to further spaces in our houses. So that is the function. When you have to do the same thing in a huge, really, really huge industry, that is going to be called as a switchgear. Moving on further, and this is a definition where, sorry for the image, but yes, motors above 2.5 kilowatts are now very often three-phase. So all the motors that we usually use is three-phase because of the complexity and the capacity that they're going to handle. And they can be found in boiler rooms, kitchen ventilation plants, etc., 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 etc. Huge installations. Any equipment of this nature will need a three-phase supply, but distribution to lights and fine. So this is just a normal text that I've put. But what happens is, so this is a main building, this is annex building. So this is all coming to the facility, which is the distribution center. And from the topmost cabin, it goes to some other space, which is again going to another subsidiary center, distribution center, which is again dealing, handling four other spaces under the annex building. Again, if you see in the bottom, it is going to some other service. So what happens is, this distribution through subsidiary centers, how are we going to do it? So when in a house we talk about distribution boards, it is just something which is going to be located in the wall. But when you're talking about a huge facility, acres and acres of land, and with different blocks, we can't think of something or how many boxes can we put. So imagine the a box that we have in a house with so much of circuit breakers, how many such boxes can we put? So in such cases, we take the help of a switch gear. So this is going to be the switch gear subsidiary center, and it is going to make the communication easier, or organized communication, so that the buildings communicate with each other, and the person or the facility management team can have a better understanding, and they can also run the facility in a much better fashion so that it can be made very efficient. So this is a switch gear. Now, just that we've been talking about switch gear or distribution boards at houses, we will know what a distribution board is, and from then we will move further to our fuses and circuit breakers. Distribution boards, I think all of us by now are familiar with that. A distribution board may be defined as a unit comprising one or more protective devices against overcurrent. So now the distribution board is not for the overcurrent. It is defined as a unit comprising one or more components. Out of those components, there will be one or more protective devices as well. These protective devices are for the overcurrent, to protect against the overcurrent and ensuring the distribution of electrical energy to the circuits. It is wise to select distribution boards which provide plenty of wiring space, because all the wires in the house or the room is going to come in that particular box or niche that we have made, and on top of it is where our distribution box is going to be. And sometimes it can protrude, sometimes some of us want it to be flushed. As architects, we don't want them to get in, right? So in such cases, how do you plan that? So it is wise to select a distribution board which provides plenty of wiring space and with adequate terminals to size and accommodate various cables which will be of different sizes, different colors, different strategies. So all those have to be neatly connected. So it should have ample space to accommodate all of them. So very often it is necessary to install a cable which is larger than it would normally be required in order to limit voltage drop. And sometimes the main terminals are not sufficient or are not of sufficient size to accommodate these larger cables. So like I told you, the cables are going to be of different sizes. So it is always wise to go for larger diameter, larger holes and provisions and spaces, considering we are going to use bigger cables, and plan this box and location accordingly. Therefore, the distribution board should be selected with main terminals of sufficient size for these larger cables, right? We will discuss some more about a distribution board. This is a quick image where if you can relate to whatever I've been talking about, distribution boards, probably this will tell us what I'm actually talking about. In a closed position, all that we are going to see is just a door, right? So once when you open the door, so it says doors and cable entries manufactured from high impact UV stabilized engineering grade resin. Okay. Glow wire rating has to be 850 degrees Celsius. So in case of fire, if the distribution board is gone, the entire purpose of powering up the house is going to be lost. So yes, that is to be taken care. 20 mm O-ring minimum all around the boards to hide gaps in the walls. So yes, so that we don't see the gaps between the door opening and the frame. Removable front cover allows easy access so that we cover all this tiny circuit breaker switches. And ample room. Okay, this is what we've been talking about. Ample room for circuit labeling, top and bottom, transparent cover provided to protect labeling. So ample room is what I spoke to you about in the previous slide. But what they talk about here is what do they mean by labeling? So labeling, because we spoke about these are going to be the, imagine, equate these switches which is going to be here, circuit breakers or switches, let's keep it as switches for now, are the brokers. So when we go to a new city and trying to find a house, and these days you have online websites, but yes, so imagine these switches, there are series of switches, if I have to tell 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of this, which is seen here, right? So there are 8 of these, each of these are going to be switches, or imagine here, relate them to brokers. So they're going to have handle a particular area where they will have knowledge about, right? So one person is going to be responsible for, let's say, street number 1 to 10. Second person is going to take care of 11 to 14, 11 to 15. Third person from 16 to 20. Likewise, we cover the entire city, the entire area, right? Locality. So each of these guys are going to have a particular responsibility in terms of who's going to handle what. In such cases, so now that they coordinate among themselves, it's a different scenario. But when it comes here, so we are going to, when we go there and open something, we should be knowing which is for what. So now imagine you have G+3 house, and this is going to happen in the ground floor, the main distribution board. You should know which is controlling what. So the first two switches which is provided is going to, let's say, control the ground floor lighting. So you will have to write it in the top saying ground floor lighting, so that when there is a fault and when some light in the ground floor is not working, so you don't have to switch off and switch on and each switch which is put here at top and bottom to find out which is a fault line, so that we can isolate, repair the bulb, repair the lights, luminaires, and get back before we switch it on, right? So how do we isolate the circuit? So we need to switch that off so that we can work on the circuit and get back to the work, right, before we energize the circuit. So that is why labeling is important. This particular manufacturer who's saying labeling, ample space for circuit labeling is where you can write in the top and bottom saying for what it is, which is it, which circuit is taken care by this particular switch or the circuit breaker. And next is the door opening, which is normal. When you have a door, it has to open. Some of them open, some of them are top hinged, some of them open like this, depending upon the capacity and the number of circuit breakers which is going to happen. So it can be as big as this, or as small as this, or as small as this. This is a very common thing which all of us must have seen. This, the main thing was going to be a bit different from all others is obviously going to be our main switch. And we have several other people sitting, looking very similar to each other. And over here it says it is MCB. We will be looking at what is an MCB in a short while. Miniature circuit breakers, and this is a residual circuit device. And just because these three also looks similar to these, so it should also be MCBs, right? Other words, switches. Let's keep it a switches for now. Okay, distribution boards. So this is what I was talking about. Over here they have split the entire board into enclosure, service connection, lightning protection, overcurrent protection and isolation, protection against direct and indirect current, and protection against fire, remote control, energy management, right? So enclosure is a casing that we know, incoming power supply, circuit breaker is the main, which is coming and waiting for you in the wall. And lightning protection, we have surge arresters. We will be studying about this. We'll try to touch this in the next module. Overcurrent protection and isolation, this is all our circuit breakers. Protection against different contacts and fire, we again have some circuit breakers. Remote control switch, that's a switch. Energy management, thermostats. Thermostats is basically nothing but your choke, or very similar to your fan regulator, right? And programmable time switch. So these are something which not all the distribution boards should have, but it can have. So there will be provision for all of this, if not for one or two. So it is up to the requirement on how one is going to plan the provisions made in the distribution board. But yes, distribution board is just going to be this, again a box with several holes in it and a door, right? Okay, now what are the types of distribution boards that we can think of? There are three types of distribution boards. One is completely fitted with rewearable fuse links. Next is HBC fuse links. Third is circuit breakers. So we will take up all these three alone and see what they are. There are many objections to the use of I'm sorry to start with objections, but yeah, rewearable fuses. Again, people who've had an opportunity, depending upon where you grow in your 90s, we used to have, probably some of us still, not some of us, many of us still use this when the government supply gets metered. You have this insulated box kind of thing where, porcelain, this thing where you see a copper wire running from the top to the bottom, and you plug that in, and that is when your house gets energized. And there are cases when you don't pay your fees on time, the representative from the electricity board will come and take that alone, and you won't be able to replace it by yourself. So that they tell you that you go pay the fees along with the fine or whatsoever and get back, and we'll have to go collect that fuse, the other side of the fuse covering, and plug it in so that the copper wire, the copper connects one end with the other end so that our house gets energized, right? So yes, there is very little guarantee that the fuse link chosen at the time of installation will not be replaced by a larger fuse link. There is so much to be done for this particular. There is so much to be said for choosing distribution boards fitted with MCB. So this is slowly losing its value because of the complexity it has. Again, if depending upon where you grew up, you might or might not had an opportunity to change a fuse at times. When you overload your circuit with the mixer, refrigerator, everything on, probably sometimes the fuse gets burnt and you have to take that out. We used to have copper wires, replace the entire fuse and put it back after switching all your heavy appliances off, so it again starts functioning. So that is a fuse. With that understanding, we will be taking up more types of these in the upcoming slides. So HBC fuse is high breaking capacity fuse. This has been designed to clear a potentially dangerous short circuit within a fraction of seconds. It would be a great disadvantage if these same fuses operated with equal promptitude every time temporary overload occurs. and would result in considerable expense for fuse link replacements. This is the reason HBC fuse links are designed so that they will withstand as much as 5 times full load current for a few seconds, by which time the fault will probably be cleared. So this is basically high braking capacity because of the time that it is going to respond to the given fault conditions, and it is 5 times more capable. It can take a maximum of 5 times than the actual load for a few seconds. Sometimes the electron's movement is such that it will just clear, balance it out in the circuit, but it is very fast and it can take more loads. This is what is HBC high braking capacity fuses are. Next is our distribution boards fitted with MCBs are used to be expensive, but it is not now. They have much to commend them. Especially they can incorporate an earth leakage strip. There are several types of MCBs. All of them are going to look maybe similar, or you can distinguish them. These of course are going to be, there are so many in number depending upon your strategies and the electrical designer's intent. So they come in various ratings from 5 amps to 16 amps, all of which are of the same physical size and therefore easily interchangeable. So it is just a matter of taking that out, putting into the casing of our distribution box, right? Moving on further, before we get into the types of circuit breakers, if you have to talk about the evolution of this, it started with switch. So basically it is about a circuit, open circuit and a closed circuit, and that is where we discovered switch. And switch itself is actually a form of fuse that when we don't want a circuit, we make or break a circuit, right? So when we do what it is a switch. Fuse is when the circuit decides to break itself when there is so much of current, so that it protects the devices. Bimetallic relay is a relay, so we all know what a relay game is. So it is again signal between two ends whether to make or break the circuit. Miniature circuit breakers. There are types of miniature circuit breakers. MCB, ELCB, RCCB and MCCB. We will be studying about this. And these are the circuit breakers that we use in our domestic households. Circuit breakers for larger electrical installations are OCB, oil circuit breakers, air blast circuit breakers, SF6 circuit breakers and vacuum circuit breakers. What is the difference between fuse and a circuit breaker? A fuse, the moment when there is overcurrent and it has to protect against the overcurrent, it burns off and it can't be replaced. It will break the circuit and it has to be replaced once when it breaks the circuit. Whereas circuit breakers, they break the circuit and it's just a matter of switching them on and we don't have to replace anything. That's a major difference between fuse and circuit breakers. So what is a fuse? Whoever again had an opportunity to open or know something about your bike, car and any other electronic equipments will know, you must have seen this. So this is a DC fuse. Most of us, this is very commonly seen in our bike headlights or car headlights, right? Then the entire system is powered with a DC battery. So from this is a fuse to, again, this, I have seen it in my childhood days. I'm not sure how many of you have had an opportunity to see this. The wire that you see in between is used as a fuse element, so that is going to burn if there is in case of overcurrent, right? So from this to this to all of these are going to be our fuse. So there are several types of fuse, all of them used for the same function depending upon their requirement and where they are going to be used. And this is, I have just given you so that we understand what exactly is happening inside it. There's a filling powder, this is a bimetal thermal control, there's a thermal control, and this is the fuse element which is going to burn. Cartridge, fuse contact link, we'll have currents, wires coming from either sides, right? And when there is movement more than what is allowed or senses more electrons than what is allowed, this fuse element is going to burn. Okay, so now the necessity of a fuse. So electrical equipments are designed to carry a particular rated value of current under normal circumstances. Right? So under normal conditions, everything under abnormal conditions, such as short circuit overload or any fault, the current raises above or below the value, damaging the equipment and resulting sometimes in a fire hazard. Right? So fuses are pressed into operation in such conditions where it is going to act as a safety device. So that it prevents the devices and fire hazard by just breaking the circuit. It is a short length of wire made of some of these materials having a low melting point. So this is what is going to be the game changer. So this is going to have a relatively low melting point than all our cables that we use, and low resistance losses, in fact, you know, low ohmic losses, right? So under normal operating conditions, it is designed to carry the full load current, but if the current increases beyond the design value, the fuse melts, or sometimes it is said to be blown, isolating the power supply from the load. So under normal operating conditions, it is designed to carry the full load, and in case of any increase beyond the design value, it is going to melt or blow, isolating the power supply from the load. And there are types of fuses. One is a totally enclosed fuse, another one is a semi-enclosed fuse, and they differ in their own ratings in terms of how much current they can carry or how much load they can withstand. So this is our semi-enclosed, I was talking about this, and this is a totally enclosed fuse. And over here we will have a quick look at the types of fuses that we have. Rewirable kit. This is called as KitKat fuses. These fuses are simple in construction, cheap, and available up to a current rating of 200. There are so much of errors in their operation, and the performance deteriorates over time. So plug fuse is a fuse carrier provided with a glass window for visual inspection of the fuse wire. Cartridge fuse, we must have seen this. The fuse wire is usually an alloy of lead, which is enclosed in a strong fiber casing. The fuse element is fastened to copper caps at the end of the casing. They are available up to a voltage of 25 kilovolts. Miniature cartridge fuses, miniature version of the higher rating cartridge fuses, which are extensively used in automobiles, TV sets, other electronic equipments. Transformer fuse blocks, these porcelain housed fuses are placed on secondary of the distribution transformers for protection against short circuits and overloads. So if you look at this, this is a time delay fuse especially designed to withstand current overload for a limited time so that it can withstand and respond according to the necessity. So these are given for the examination purposes. You can go through this so that we understand the types, overall types, but I will quickly move on to the ones which is mentioned in the syllabus. First is ELCB, which is called as earth leakage circuit breakers. If you can make out from the name, it is going to break the circuit when it senses a leakage from the earth wire, right? So we have studied about these three wires where the top is going to be earth, one is going to be neutral, one is going to be phase or line. Whenever there is a leakage that is sensed in the earth wire, that is when we are going to use the earth leakage circuit breaker. I will quickly read it up for you. Current leaks from any electrical installation due to insulation failure in the electrical circuit must be properly detected and prevented outside. Otherwise, there may be a high chance of electrical shock. An earth leakage circuit breaker detects earth leakage current and shuts the power supply off by opening the associated circuit breaker. There are two types of earth leakage circuit breaker. One is earth leakage current circuit breaker, which is also called as RCCB residual current circuit breaker. And next is earth leakage voltage circuit breakers. Next is a miniature circuit breaker. Miniature circuit breaker automatically switches off the electrical circuit during an abnormal condition of network in terms of its overload or faulty condition. MCCBs are used primarily as an alternative to the fuse switch in most of the circuits, and it comes with various ratings, and there are so many types of MCBs depending upon the ratings and their applications, which can be used for various operations. So what is miniature circuit breaker? It is manufactured with the different pole versions such as single, double, triple and four pole structures with different fault current levels, and the MCCBs are linked to give two or three pole versions such that a fault in one line will break and break the complete circuit, and hence complete circuit isolation are provided. So like I told you, they have different rating in terms of voltages, in terms of amperes, depending upon the phases, and sometimes it is used to adjust the tripping current, right? So there are so many functions MCB can perform according to the requirement that we have, and it may look something like this, and half of this will be inserted inside your distribution boards where we spoke about the ample provisions, and the wire is going to come and sit in the back. I will show another slide where we can understand what happens inside this. So this is a cross section of an MCB. So this is a tripping lever operating mechanism. This is what is seen by us, whereas the rest is all hidden, and this is where this side is where is going to be rested in our distribution board, right? So this is where they put the labeling and all that. So what happens is there are so much of coils, protection levers, bimetal relays and all that. So technically we will have the wires coming at one end and leaving from the other end. So whenever there is a sense of extra current or voltage or any of it, whichever the MCB is designed to function for, based on that, when there is a something which is sensed extra, then it is going to trip. This lever is going to make this operating mechanism go on or off by itself, go off by itself, so that we check the reason on why it could have tripped, and if we have overloaded the circuit, we can accordingly switch off some of the equipments, come back and switch it on, right? So this is our MCB. On what basis do we select a circuit breaker? So there are three important factors that one can consider. So one is the nominal rating of the circuit breaker, which is the current rating. Next is the kilo amps rating or the breaking capacity, and when does it break. Third is the type for which we are going to use it for. So nominal rating of the circuit breaker, current rating value must be lower than the current rating capacity of the wiring system. Of course, we discussed this is going to have a relatively low melting point, and higher than or equal to the maximum full load current of the wiring system. Generally, this should be such that it can handle 125% of continuous load. Sometimes it has to take more load so that it doesn't trip often because of some faults, right? Plus rating of non-continuous load. Typically, this can be expressed as maximum full load of the current system, less than or equal to current rating of MCB, less than or equal to cable rating. Kilo amp rating or breaking capacity, this rating refers to the capability of MCB that can trip or interrupt the circuit under short circuit conditions or any faulty conditions. Type of MCB, we have already discussed so many applications or the usage of a particular MCB. So depending upon what basis the circuit has to be broken, based on that we can decide the type of MCB, right? Under MCB, we again have a couple of types, which is type B, type C, type D. What changes here is this trips instantly at a rate of 3 to 5 times its rated current, whereas type C trips instantly at the rate of 5 to 10 times, whereas type C starts from 10 to 20 times than its rated current. Usually this is for small inductive loads, whereas this is for a relatively large or high inductive loads, whereas this is for even more high inductive loads, right? And so their application will differ from normal residential building to higher operations like industries and commercial operations. This is RCD, residual current device. Like the name indicates, it is going to take the residues which is left in the current, right? So this device is again frequently used. This is a circuit breaker which detects a current leaking to earth and uses this leakage current to operate the tripping mechanism. And the leakage current is a residual current and gives the device its name. It should be noted here that this device will not protect against short circuit and overload, right? it just takes care of the residual current alone. And we move on to the bigger monsters here. So all that CBs, ELCB, RCCB, MCCB, miniature circuit breaker, earth leakage circuit breaker, and various other types that we studied is all for relatively less applications in terms of the load that they're going to operate or handle. As we move on to higher loads, higher currents, and where we have to be really precise about the operation, that is when we move on to these air, oil, or SF6, and even vacuum for that matter. Number one is circuit breaker, which uses compressed air as arc quenching medium to exterminate the arc produced when the contacts are separated. So nothing but the separating medium, the tripping mechanism is going to be achieved through compressed air, and that is going to be our air circuit breakers. Next is our oil circuit breakers. In oil circuit breakers, the contacts of the breaker are made to separate within an insulating oil. Next is sulfur hexafluoride SF6 circuit breaker, in which SF6 under pressure, that is a gas which is used to extinguish the arc. So basically the medium where in our MCBs we had the wire and it was operating in a different medium, over here we use air, oil and gas as a medium to break the arc or the entire circuit, right? So with this we have covered our protective devices. I believe some of it is covered, some of it if you feel is still missed out, you are free to take it forward in terms of more types, because there are so many types that one can look at here. And with this we have covered our lecture number 9 and 10 in terms of, it's just one lecture, but to follow the sequence, every module subheading I've been giving it as two subheads. So now 9 and 10 together is completed with this. 11 and 12 will be our earthing and lightning arrestors. Thank you.